thinking about this subject. Mm-hmm. See, what do you mean by scale? Okay, you said, oh, maybe it's different by scale. There's something in it in scale. Mm-hmm. Listen to reason as it can. This happen to any nation?
Mm-hmm.
If it's on a scale, there's something about, say, China's size.
Mm-hmm.
Can you say that something, this is really the thing?
Well, so the scale essentially means that, you know, in terms of the size of the population, that it's many times that of Japan. But if you look at the comparisons, you know, like say, if you compare China today with like Taiwan in the 50s, 60s, you know, we find similar parallels of levels of growth, and then the only thing is one is smaller, the other bigger. Now, if you think, well, are there any other country could repeat what they're trying to do, we'll look at India. India is not growing very, very high speed, right? So even though it's not really at a stage in China yet, but that's all similarly a very large population and society. But then again, I would actually, in along the line of what I'm talking about today, is that in India's case, even though India is a democracy, but India would face a similar problem to China later when it comes to its time, because it's also considered as non-white population. So that's what I'm saying, like if we think about the rise of the global south and that kind of discourse analysis, yeah. And then the implicitly is this kind of challenge to the global north, is the challenge of the Eurocentric vision. But in terms of your argument that there must be something that's specific to Chinese that made it so, it was a miracle, I don't want to subscribe to the argument, I don't necessarily think that is necessarily that anything particular about Chinese.
May I make one suggestion?
Yeah.
Because you know what I'm saying. I think the Chinese communists, when they took over China, the single factor they did change the landscape, entire landscape, is the nationalization of the land. They abolish all the private ownership of land. And that it took some years, but decades later, this is today's reason they need to take any land, I'll build a factory. I don't have to go ask you for what's the U.S. environmental studies for the individual property rights.
Right.
I'll just do it.
That was actually a popular story, similar story in Japan and in South Korea, in Taiwan, in particular period as well. So one thing that if you want to look at specific things about land, one thing that people do talk about, the miracle of East Asian development state, is land reform. Land reform occurred in South Korea, in Taiwan, as well in Japan, significantly improved inequality in land distribution, but also in terms of how state, at that particular stage, would be able to control the land distribution and then access to land. So I'm actually saying that in the 60s, 70s in Taiwan, you want to build a road, you can do it too. Yes, in the back.
Have you done any comparisons between reactions to China and reactions to Russia as the other authoritarian superpower to challenge the rest of the
countries? So this is actually interesting. So I did not study this one, but somehow someone, so I give a talk in a different context, and someone mentioned that to me, is that whenever Russia starts challenging the West, and then Russia become portrayed as Asiatic and non-white. And in other times, it's considered as a Western. But then become challenging and threatening, and basically the emphasis is always on the Asiatic part. And I think I found that very, very interesting. So in a way that, even though I don't really study the Russian power story, but I think there is some element of truth to the element that somehow when it becomes threatening, and then it's the Oriental aspect of Russia, because Russia is always like either you're European or you're Asiatic, right? And then I found that was a very interesting comment that I received once when they mentioned the Russian story.
Taking up his point,
yeah.
Perhaps there is something if you want to talk about hegemony.
Yeah.
It's not just that the right thing has to come at the right time, the right population base, the right, young people
mm.
able to support
mm.
the youth wellness
mm.
And to take advantage of it at the correct moment.
Mm.
But to be a hegemon, you also need an ideology.
Mm.
The U.S. had a manifest destiny ideology. China has, we're going to end 100 years of humiliation.
Mm.
Call it what you want, it's the same kind of myth.
Mm.
And I think that has to be there for a hegemon to arise.
Mm.
But and with respect to the land, that's very interesting. That was very important in kick-starting the economy. But it's also an Achilles heel. Because now what happened in the cities, they gave the people their land, essentially free, no property tax. But in the rural areas, they didn't do it. Now you have great inequality. And that, unless China changes its ways, that's going to be a problem, a big problem.
What do you mean by giving land for free?
The people who were in the city,
yeah,
who lived in their apartments, who had the huku,
right,
were given title to their land.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I'm not aware of it. I don't know. I'm not aware of people giving title to land.
You have ownership title.
They have ownership.
The apartment.
The apartment,
yes,
not the land.
Yes,
the land.
And that has gone up in value.
I don't know. I think China still doesn't have land ownership. It's 70 years the leasehold. Yeah, doesn't have land rights. You can't, yeah, it's a leasehold.
But
that's
they don't have that in the rural areas.
Rural areas also have leasehold to land, but it's not ownership.
The land gets taken away, as I understand it.
No, you cannot have land. It's a leasehold. Yeah.
Okay.
But I'm saying though that what I emphasize here, the hegemony is not simply that you need a dead sort of ideology. So the idea is manifest destiny, right, or the 100 years of like whatever. But the emphasis here on the hegemony part is not on the ideology part. It's whether this ideology will be accepted by others as the legitimate ideology, right? And I think that is what U.S. does. The democracy and human rights kind of thing as a manifest ideology that is at one point accepted by the many many countries in the West etc. as the order that should hold together, right? But then in that case, the Chinese one doesn't have that ideology that can be accepted by the West either. Yeah. Yes.
I don't know, but I have seen that you seem kind of afraid. With kind of like this desirability. Yeah,
okay.
I mean, it seems to me that Gramsci doesn't comment on. So I'm wondering whether or not, I mean, in your view, I mean, does Gramsci comment on the desirability of food?
Mm.
Or does he simply grant that, you know, like it's already established? I mean, so it's in a certain sense that, you know, like, so as long as the authority is granted, I mean, to not to receive ways, I mean, that's one of the first West concept of, you know, like. The agenda, right? So, yeah, so it's one way, I mean, the implications that this has on your analysis. I was kind of wondering, I mean, like, could it be read in a certain way that through its fears, I mean, that Germany constructs China as the object of, yeah, you know, of, you know, as a certain power, that instead of, you know, like being seen as, you know, so in a certain way, I mean, to recognizing China as the object of the sphere, I mean that it wants China's certain sense of power, right? So instead of being, denying China its powers, yeah. So, so in a certain way, I mean, does it not grant China's powers rather than deny of, you know, powers, and that, you know, and that both U.S. and China are being seen as powers, just that, you know, like probably Germany relates to U.S. through desire, whereas Germany relates to China through fear, and that both are seen as.
Mm. So, but this is actually interesting, the desirability and the legitimacy, right? But for me, the reason when I talk about this is sort of like consented war, right? And that's basically people are willing to follow, or willing to submit its rule to the other. But that not necessarily is a desirable. Well, that desirability is part of it, right?
I'm not questioning whether it has to be, because it seems that there are ways of recognizing channels of power without recognizing it as a kind of like desirable form of power.
Yeah, but you will not but you are not likely to consent to its leadership, though, because if you don't think it has legitimacy. So even though you think it's not desirable, but if you don't think that one has the capacity or that you will consent to, then you will have not legitimacy. My problem is that how do you differentiate this legitimacy from the desirability part? Can you have a legitimacy that is not desirable?
I don't think so.
Like in what way?
Right, so I think by recognizing China as, so I think the issue that the world that Germany and the West has, I mean, is that, it recognizes China as having a certain, as having a certain influence,
mm.
that stands, it has potential or has a risk, of standing at a certain, at a pedestal or, at an equal level as that of the West, right? So it's not a way it grants China recognition, it grants China a certain sense of power, right?
Mm.
It grants China a certain sense of, of being legitimate in certain ways, but in non-desirable ways,
mm.
in ways that it sees as threats. And it is besides, it's because of threat, which is why it sees China as powerful.
Mm.
Right, so in a certain way, I'm kind of not sure whether or not, by seeing China as a threat, that proves, or it kind of functions as a barrier to China's rights, or does it facilitate China's rights in a certain sense of being recognized?
I see what you're saying. So basically, that if you're saying that it's possible to envision a future that the China is as powerful, as equal as the West, but it's not undesirable of the other.
So I'm saying that it already envisions China as a threat,
right.
at a position already. It doesn't have to
that's
be.
That's a recognition
right or not.
Of power. Yeah.
Like when you recognize power, that's that's a recognition, right?
Right.
By recognizing that as a threat, you're constructing that reality for yourself.
Right.
Right. And you're granting it a certain kind of influence.
Right.
Upon you.
Right.
And that functions as a hegemony. That functions in a kind of like.
Yeah, but still though, in the end, let's say talk about, so not simply it's about China, but also in the end, contemporary speaking, right, the contemporary international order is American hegemony, right? But can you imagine a situation that China have this hegemony? Because my argument is that it cannot, because it will not be able to be accepted. That's why you cannot talk about hegemony.
Okay, I don't know. Does it matter whether I think of China as rising? Because it seems to me that your research is about Germany's impression.
Right, exactly. But that's the point is actually if the public do not accept its legitimate status, then this hegemony will never be achieved. Right? So hegemony requires the fundamental consent of the public, and that we call hegemony. Right? But then if the public will not subscribe to the idea that the other is going to be able to have this status, and then this hegemony will not be able to maintain. But that's what I'm saying. But I understand when you talk about the desirability.
No, that is Gramsci's framework the most suitable for this analysis.
Mm.
That's my question.
What do you think it would be the most suitable?
I don't know. It seems to me that that your analysis, it suggests more than what Gramsci can afford.
Mm.
And I don't know if it pays.
Final question for me. It's very interesting though, observe the conversation here. So I'm wondering if you could clear further, because in my mind,
mm.
hegemonic power doesn't mean that the subjects had to accept it or give consent. It's just imposed on you. And I mean, don't get me wrong, I think the United States as a civilization did a lot of good things, but still, think about sanctions imposed on Venezuela, and how Germany and other Venezuela. Thank you. Yes, I have a problem with pronunciation. Venezuela. Nothing so much to do with Germany, but see what Germany responded. They approved the sanction and saying the current government is illegitimate in the legitimate while the case is there are many supporters of Maduro back the country. So my point is how I'm wondering if you could further sharpen your thought on hegemonic power. If this has to be
in my mind, hegemonic power is not simply a materialistic use of might, but also comes with a perceived of right in it. It's a mixture of both. Right? You cannot have, for example, you can talk about a Soviet Union you have the military capability, but then your rule was perceived as legitimate in a certain aspect, right? So that for me is not hegemony per se.
Oh, okay. Yes. I can see your point. Thank you.
Any other comments? I actually admit that this is like a lot of problems, particularly methodologically, because we had a hunch, but then somehow it was very difficult to find evidence to prove that that's the case. And so that's why we don't know whether textual analysis is the right way to do it, and whether we need to use other research methodologies, such as some kind of experiment might be a better way. But I think the point I try to emphasize, perhaps to take away, is the thematic conceptualization of the racialized international order and how hegemony can come about and how it will be able to be accepted. And I think that was the emphasis here, is that there are a lot more barriers to China's case than what we generally consider. Yeah.
I think you're belittling his original question.
Mm.
I think his point is hegemony power in the Western mind about China is or can be a pure invention. It's a straw man invented by the Western through the historical perspective.
Mm.
But in actuality, it does not exist in the Chinese way of thinking. And I think this is the thing. If you keep on thinking about this, and the danger of inventing a straw man and then attack the straw man,
far
more important than what you are trying to say.
Right. So I agree with you saying that it might actually be a straw man, right? It might actually be the reason why it's a pick of bold man, and that's the reason why you can have imagined enemy, and then you can mobilize a domestic whatever. That makes sense, but historically though, China did have hegemony in East Asia. Right? That hegemony was real, right? In terms of the appointment of ranks and appointment of investiture of leadership, etc. on the neighboring states. That's real. That hegemony was there. Was not invented. Was not never China. Was never a hegemonic state. It was at one point. Right? But today, perhaps is the case that you might that all these discussions today is all part of a game, and I think probably there's a possibility that is the case. All right, thank you very much. Thank you.